Next, I would like to kindly invite Prof. Thor Hansen, who is a professor of pediatric and neonatology, as well as the director of clinical ethics at Oslo University Hospital. His presentation will be about does palliative medicine have a role in neonatology? Please.
Thank you. And my compliments to all who are present here, as to all as our lady companions in the other auditorium. And if I could get some assistance in bringing up my presentation, that would be appreciated. Thank you, kindly. Okay, and I was tasked today with trying to answer the question that you see on this slide: does palliative medicine have a role in neonatology? So let's start by trying to define what we mean by palliative care. And I've gone to the World Health Organization to look for a definition. And I've tried to highlight in cursive what I perceive to be the key words here. So it's an approach that improves the quality of life of patients and their families facing the problem associated with life-threatening illness through the prevention and relief of suffering by means of early identification, impeccable assessment and treatment of pain and other problems, physical, psychosocial, and spiritual. So palliative care provides relief from pain and other distressing symptoms. And the next sentence, I think, is one of the more important in my reading. It affirms life, but it regards dying as a normal process. And it doesn't try to neither hasten nor postpone death. Integrates psychology and spiritual life, offers a support system to help patients live as actively as possible until death, also supports the family during the illness of the patient, and also very important in my thinking, uses a team approach, and I'll get back to that later. So palliative care then, properly considered, should enhance quality of life, could potentially have a positive influence on how the illness plays out, and can actually be applied at many points in time during an illness process. The fact that you include palliation in the treatment plan does not exclude the possibility that you can at the same time apply therapies that could prolong life, such as, for instance, in cancer, chemotherapy or radiation. Now, the World Health Organization also has suggested a definition as far as palliative care for children, and tell us that this is the active total care of the child's body, mind and spirit, involves supporting the family, begins when a disease is diagnosed, and continues whether or not active treatment directed specifically towards the disease is started. It also counsels us as health providers that we must evaluate and do our best to alleviate physical, psychological, and social distress. So once again, we get back to this team approach to palliation, a broad multidisciplinary approach, including the family, community resources, and even if your resources are limited, you will have some resources that you can apply. And you can apply this approach at different places, certainly in the hospitals, but also in health centers and even in the home. So here's some of my thoughts on palliative care. My first point is palliative care is not just for the dying. And as importantly in my thinking, it does not imply giving up. I sometimes hear from patients who have been to see colleagues and have been told, we can't do anything more for you. I don't know if you have heard that at times. Now, to me, that is the major cop-out for any physician who has the aim of caring for his patients or her patients. So palliative care is not about giving up. Palliative care is about thinking differently about what our goals for the treatment plan and care plans are. It requires us, expects us really, to care both for and about our patients. And let me stress as strongly as I can, you have not failed your patient just because you start to include thoughts on palliation in your treatment plan. So here's a figure to try to reinforce the message about a broad multidisciplinary approach. Nursing is a part of it. Treatment, meaning what we as doctors try to have our hands in, but also caring is part of that multidisciplinary approach. Now, there are different models for palliative care. In the traditional approach, curative and palliative are sort of separated in two compartments, which may end up with palliative care being an afterthought, not really something that we had in mind initially. And sometimes it gets forgotten. In an integrated approach, palliative care is an integral part of the care that we offer patients, and in fact is on the same level as other approaches to treatment and care. Now, as far as goals for care, let us attempt a few definitions here as well. Curative treatment, that's what we doctors most like to do, right? We like to cure our patients. I hope primarily because we want to be good people and we want to do well for our patients. And sometimes, let's admit it, it supports our ego as well. When we can fix it, it makes us happy. But the goal, of course, then is to cure patients. Life-prolonging treatment has its goal, as the term states, to prolong the patient's life. Classical example is when you go back to the start of intensive care medicine during the polio epidemics in the 1950s, where, for instance, we are told in Scandinavia that in Copenhagen, medical students were tasked with hand-ventilating polio patients who, through their paralysis, had lost the ability to breathe on their own. So that's life prolonging. Palliative symptom preventing treatment has the purpose of, or the goal of, trying to prevent, if we can, or at least delay the appearance of symptoms, which may appear quite soon, and possibly, if we can, also to delay progression of disease. And then symptom-relieving palliation obviously wants to alleviate symptoms that cause discomfort to the patient. And we may treat one or more such symptoms. Now, are babies even ever in need of palliation? Well, we know for certain that babies, like us, experience physical pain. I am old enough to remember a time that our cardiac surgeons did not believe that preemie babies had pain perception. So preemie babies with an open duct had thoracotomies and ductal ligation with nothing but neuromuscular blockade. So let's not get too haughty. The history is not that distant. Now, is there any reason to think that pain is good for babies? There really isn't. What we know today is that pain, which can be alleviated, can be very destructive to the healing process. Now, we can't know for certain whether babies experience emotional or existential pain or suffering, but I've been privileged to be the father of three young people who were once babies, and certainly in caring for those babies, I come away with a clear understanding and recollection that babies need to be loved and comforted. And that is not just because they have a tummy ache. Can we fix everything? Well, I'd like a show of hands from those who think they can fix everything. My statement is, no, we absolutely cannot fix everything. I've given you a few examples. Stefan just talked about severe asphyxia. We can fix some of it, but as he described, not all. Extreme immaturity, well, certainly when we get down to 22 weeks and below, there really isn't much we can do. Anencephaly, we cannot fix that. A number of metabolic disorders are still beyond our ability to fix. And there are several chromosomal abnormalities that, for the most part, run a very dismal course. But among those examples that I have mentioned to you, there are some infants who live for a while, and some of them undoubtedly suffer. 41%, the WHO tells us, of deaths in children younger than 5 years happen in the newborn period, and you can see the listing of the causes on the right-hand segment of that circle. I've been a pediatrician for 40-plus years and a neonatologist for 30 of those years. It's been a privilege. I have loved being a doctor for children, and I continue to love little babies. In fact, I'm getting more and more nutty as I have gone along. And it's been fun, because during the years that I have been in practice, the number of tools that have become available to us to help sick babies has just exploded. And once again, here is a list that is by no means exhaustive. Respirators, ECMO, dialysis, TPN, INUN, chronotropic support, monitoring for this, that, and whatever, blood tests in microvolume, IV catheters and tiny, tiny central lines, neonatal surgery for heart and other malformations. It's spectacular. When I think of what we were able to do when I first set my foot in a NICU in February of 1976, and I think of what we do today, it's just amazing. And it's been fun. Now, there is a potential problem, though, because we have these new tools and these new skills. It appears that occasionally it creates a compulsion in us to use these tools just because we can. Now, if a baby is born anencephalic, does not breathe, we can put that baby on a vent. Has low blood pressure? Well, let's start epinephrine or dopamine. Does not pee? Well, we can dialyze. Does not eat? Well, we can gavage feed or we can give TPN. But we cannot, as much as we would love to, we cannot give this baby a life that she or he is aware of or present in. Therefore, I put it to you that because we have developed this arsenal, this toolbox of exciting things we can do, to a much greater extent than that which was the case when I started in 1976. It forces us to think about whether we always must do all that we can do. Or perhaps, and here's an alternative thought, we should sit down, have a respectful and sensitive dialogue with mom and dad, and think very seriously about what are our choices, what are our goals for treatment and nursing and care. When I talk about clinical ethics in Norway, and I do that quite a bit, one of my favorite paragraphs in Norwegian law, and I confess ignorance as far as Saudi Arabian law, you must forgive me, but there is a paragraph 4 in the Norwegian law on healthcare personnel, and it makes two demands on healthcare workers. The first one says that their work must be professionally sound. Lawyers can tell you lots about professionally sounds, but it's really quite simple. It means that what you do, you must be trained and skilled at doing. Or you must be in an apprentice kind of position and be supervised by somebody who has the knowledge and skills. You must have the necessary equipment and support, and you should be in a setting where what you plan to do is in the range of what that institution is capable of doing and sustaining. But there is a second demand on healthcare personnel, and that is that their work should be caring or compassionate. Now that suggests that when we interact with our patients, there is more than just theoretical knowledge and manual skills at work. There must be some sort of a relationship between us and the patients we treat, and in the case of our babies, to their parents. So is it possible then to conceive of something to do which is professionally sound but fails the test of compassion or caring? Well, you may not all agree with my example, so this is my thinking. If I put an anencephalic baby on a ventilator, an epinephrine drip, dialysis, and TPN, it may all be professionally sound because I've done this before. I know how to do it. Our nurses know how to take care of it. You know, we're within the perimeter of what we're able to do. But there are people, and I am among those people, who question whether this is truly caring or compassionate. I put it to you that palliation is really not that unusual in neonatology. For instance, when we do a Norwood procedure on a baby with a hypoplastic left heart syndrome, we have not fixed that heart. We have created a pump that will always be at risk for failing, and although our surgeons are getting better and better, and thus life expectancy for these babies has improved, it will never be a normal heart. And we can say the same thing about several other very complex heart malformations. We also know increasingly that quite a few babies with severe complex cyanotic heart disease have problems with their brain function. So in fact then, Norwood and the Fontan procedure and other palliative surgical procedures are, in fact, palliative. But in palliating these hearts, we are providing both symptom relief and symptom prevention. So if we are to think about palliative care in neonatology, let's think about who might be appropriate candidates. I have stolen this from a very recent publication by Paravicini in Current Opinion in Pediatrics. Life-limiting conditions, then, there's a list here: anencephaly, hydranencephaly, severe holoprosencephaly, other complex CNS malformations. lethal lung hypoplasia, lethal osteogenesis imperfecta, severe hydrops, bilateral renal agenesis, complex cardiac anomalies that are inoperable or require single ventricle repair with poor prognosis, trisomies 13 and 18 and other genetics conditions, and several metabolic conditions that have a short life expectancy despite treatment. And then there are terminal conditions, such as extremely premature or immature infants who may not be viable or just at the threshold of viability. We have newborns who do not respond to our efforts to resuscitate them after birth. We have newborns who stop breathing because they have severe hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy or severe brain injury because of large intraventricular hemorrhages or periventricular leukomalacia. And we have babies who are at end stage because of lung and heart and multi-organ failure. Sometimes, at least in our country, we are already prenatally in a position to make plans. Sometimes the diagnosis and prognosis are certain, or they could be uncertain, or the diagnosis is certain, but the prognosis is not. So more and more serious conditions, life-limiting conditions, are in fact known to us prenatally. So at least in my country, this would be seen as a good opportunity to sit down with mom and dad and engage in a respectful and sensitive dialogue about what our options are and what plans we might make based on those options. So very often in my hospital, our perinatologist, when he has found a serious anomaly, life-threatening anomaly, will come to us as neonatologists and sit down and discuss with us what are we capable of offering, and very often she or he will ask us to come along and talk with mom and dad. And then we can talk about options for delivery. Maybe these people were referred from us from another part of the country, because where I work is a national referral center. And if this baby is not expected to live, these people may actually want to give birth in their simple local hospital. Whether this is acceptable to you here, I don't know. Now, there has been surveys of how parents react to this kind of approach. And there were some quality indicators that I think we can all learn from. One such indicator was consistent cure. Now, to me, that argues for placing the responsibility for such patients in the hand of a very limited number of doctors and nurses. In my hospital, we emphasize this very strongly. Parents meet the same doctor through all discussions, at least as far as a 24/7 call schedule makes it possible. If we are in any way uncertain, in doubt, we always use the team approach. Every morning on our pre-rounds, several times a week at least, we have ethics discussions. What can we do? Is it a good thing? Is it a humane thing? Would we want this for our own child? The second quality indicator that came through was compassionate care. Remember what I said about paragraph 4 in our healthcare personnel law? Professionally sound and compassionate and caring. And indeed, parents came back and said, yes, they appreciated an approach that signaled caring. And the third thing that parents came back and answered is some help with resources to cope with the emotional turmoil that they're going through. They also wanted physicians who presented the story to them to say something both about expectations in the short term and in the long term. including the developmental potential of the infant, if the infant should survive, and what possible impact this might have on the family. They also wanted to know about national and regional standards for care. And depending on where this conversation is taking place, physicians from level 3 to 4 hospitals and fetal care units, genetic units, might be available. Nowadays, they could be available on a phone link or a video link or something. We need to be honest in our communication with parents regarding options and interventions. Time of delivery, how the birth is planned to proceed, whether or not cesarean is a good option, considering that it's not a risk-free procedure for the mom, and whether or not the baby should be kept in the community hospital or should be at a high-risk referral center. Now, these early discussions are important and can contribute to establish a trusting relationship between the medical team, sometimes visiting the NICU, and we try to do that as often as we can. One of our NICU nurses will go introduce herself to the parents and invite them to come see the NICU and tell them a little bit about how this alien place functions. It's very often appropriate, even if the baby is not expected to live, to have a pediatrician present at delivery. Sometimes parents may ask to talk to other parents who have had similar experiences. And if that can be arranged, then that might be a good idea. Encouraging families to make plans for a potentially non-viable infant while the baby is in utero could be seen as empowering these patients to take care of their autonomous right in our healthcare laws. It also allows or permits the parents to go online and research for their own benefit. Now, as far as communicating with parents, I will tell you from my own personal experience that these conversations are not easy. Sometimes, if you care about people, they're heart-wrenching. As a neonatologist, I've been practicing to get good at intubation, central line placement, all the nifty things that we do and that make us proud of what we do. And I've practiced, as I'm sure have all of you, you've practiced to get good at it. And if you did not practice, how could you get better at it? I question whether we practice our skills at communication as assiduously as we practice our manual dexterity. And if we don't, how do we expect to get better at it? If after a conversation that did not go well, do we sit down with the nurse who may have come with us and ask him or her what failed? And if you don't, how can you avoid repeating whatever mistake you made? Parents need to know that they won't be abandoned. I tell the parents, if you don't see them in the NICU, just tell the nurse and she'll get a hold of me, or she'll tell me that you want to see me. I want you to feel that you know what's happening and all questions are welcome. On the subject of questions, I also make it a point to tell the parents who are sometimes afraid to ask the big professor questions. I say there are not ever any unnecessary questions, and dumb questions do not exist in my thinking. There are sometimes inadequate answers, in fact, perhaps not infrequently. It's very important that these conversations be held in private, in a quiet room, closed so you don't get interrupted. We put a big sign on the door, do not disturb. I give my beeper to a colleague and I turn off my cell phone. Baby's nurse is always with me. I always make it a strong point to avoid medical jargon. medical jargon is a perfect strategy for hiding your insecurity. And if you find yourself searching for a medical term, look inside your heart and ask whether you're trying to camouflage your fear. If I use an interpreter, then I try to speak with the interpreter ahead of time to prepare his or her mindset. After I have tried to explain something, I never ask, did you understand? Because if I ask, did you understand, I place the responsibility for understanding right smack in the lap of the parents. Okay? Rather, I ask, have I managed to explain this in the way that it was possible to understand? Then I have assumed responsibility for the explanation. We always offer support from our child psychiatry and a hospital chaplain or other spiritual advisor.
2 minutes, please.
I think that consists... Pardon?
2 minutes, please.
Thank you. Consistency is absolutely essential. It's a recipe for disaster if NICU staff disagree and communicate such disagreement. So we discuss in team, and once a decision is reached, we are all loyal to that. Finally, I don't like the term to stop treatment. Until a child is dead, I never stop being that child physician, never stop treating or caring. I sometimes change my goal for treatment and therefore change my treatment approach, but palliative care is also treatment, the goal of which is to permit the infant to die peacefully. I always have a good talk with the parents and explain to them how such a dying process will occur. And discuss with them where they want this process to happen. They're welcome to invite support people. We offer spiritual support. And when the baby is dead, the baby's neonatologist pronounces death. And then we discuss postmortem examination. They're invited to participate in postmortem care of the body. We counsel them as far as funeral arrangements. And the nurse who was present calls the parents for several days after. And then we invite them for a follow-up conversation. And they meet the primary neonatologist and one of the nurses from the care team. And they're invited to share with us what their experiences were. Finally, my own experiences from such follow-up conversations and conferences are almost all strongly positive. There was sadness and grief, but I continue and have continued through the years to be amazed and inspired over the strength and dignity that ordinary people are able to muster when life has dealt them a blow. And occasionally I find that an old guy like myself can draw on life's experiences and communicate support that way. And if that happens, I'm always inspired and grateful for a life as a pediatrician and neonatologist. So in summary, we cannot always fix everything. When we cannot fix, we may sometimes be able to imbue sadness and loss with caring and dignity. So palliative care does have a place in neonatology. Caring and compassion are perhaps inherent, but skills must be learned through assiduous practice. So please, go practice being humane and sensitive physicians and nurses, I should add. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Prof. Hansen, for your nice presentation.